I've seen people say that it shouldn't be about personal preference, that the jurors should be objective. But wouldn't it at some point? Because if you feel equally about two songs, one of them still has to go ahead of the other. And how else are you going to make that decision? What's going on, everybody? Hope you're all doing well. For the last little while, I've been working on a video about the voting system and the juries, and it's been taking a lot longer than I would have originally thought. It's actually quite a big topic, and I'm trying not to simply just regurgitate what's already been said by other people who have covered the topic. But with all this discussion about the juries, people's gripes with them, and whether or not we still need them, I thought I would put myself in the shoes of somebody who's trying to assess the songs in a professional mindset, or at least, you know, try to as a sort of exercise. So what I've done is I've rewatched the 2023 Grand Final, and I've come up with a scoring system that reflects the kind of things that I look for when making videos about Eurovision and national selections. And if you've seen those videos, I often talk about three areas, which would be song, performance, and visuals. Now, this is of course not the same as the criteria that the juries in Eurovision are given, and those criteria are vocal capacity, performance on stage, composition and originality of the song, and the overall impression by the act. The reason why I'm not following those criteria is because I'm not a musician or a music industry professional. I very much consider myself to be a music fan who has some knowledge of those concepts. Now, because it is a song contest, it wouldn't make any sense if I didn't talk about the music, so I'm still going to address them in mostly general ways. What I will do is focus a bit more on visuals because I have professional work behind me in television and digital media, and it's something that I feel like I can talk about in detail, hopefully with respect to the professionals that put these performances on stage and make them come to life. So let's revisit the grand final and talk about what each act brought to the stage. We open with Austria, one of this year's fan favorites, and a song with a lot of energy and personality. The first thing that calls my attention is that it has a very clean color palette, which, in my opinion, is one of the qualities of any performance that can help make it feel complete. A lot of the movement comes from Teja, Selena, the dancers, and their carbon copies that are on the LEDs. And this would be something that would look totally ridiculous if this was a 100% serious song, but because there's this quirky energy to it and it's kind of an absurd concept, it actually works quite well. Whether or not it brought the level of quirk that the song needed, I think is a big question. And if you ask me, it didn't fully. I understand that there is a bit of a balancing act that you want to do with these kind of entries because you don't want to go too over the top because then it just looks like a joke. So I understand the reluctance to, you know, maybe go all in on the Edgar Allan Poe ghost possession theme. But it is a question about how much entertainment value the overall package brought. So while it is lacking in some areas, it still looks very well put together and it has a visual identity. So I'm going to give this a 7.5. The song is really, really great, catchy as hell, creative, one of the most original songs of the year, so it's going to get a 9. And with the performance, there were certain notes that were noticeably missed, but I still feel like it's a competent vocal performance, and they still have character when they sing, so they're going to get a 7. Following that, we have Portugal with Mimi Cat, our cabaret queen who is channeling her love of Chicago in the performance. Some of you might know that what we saw on stage was sort of a backup plan. The delegation didn't like the LEDs that were given to them when they were looking at the technical rehearsals, so they opted to just get rid of them and use the lights instead. Had they been able to achieve their vision, we might have had something that was quite a bit more impactful. I still think that it holds up regardless, and you still get that cabaret feeling from the performers on stage. So although it's lacking a bit of a wow factor, it still looks good overall, and the energy is matched by everything that's happening on stage and with the lighting. So the visuals are going to get a 7.5. The song is great, it's catchy, it's infectious, it has a lot of personality, it's going to get an 8. And Mimi Cat is vocally strong. She's very charismatic and expressive, so she's also going to get an 8. We then get to Switzerland, which I would say is a teensy bit visually stronger than the two performances that we just saw. There's a level of dynamism here that we expect from these stagings by Sacha Jean-Baptiste and her team, which makes every performance feel energetic. The camera cuts, the lighting, the choreography, they're all major contributors to the movement, and it keeps me engaged from start to finish. Now, with all that said, I also don't consider it to be like the most exciting staging that we have, but I recognize that there's a lot of attention to detail, and there are certain standout moments. The one that I like most is with the falling fireworks. It gives me the image of like being on a battlefield and there are like bombs falling. So from a visual point of view, I'm gonna give this an 8. As for the song, I find it to be like pretty, but quite underwhelming as an overall package. I'm sure that other people would feel more strongly about it, but because I don't feel like there are enough musical elements to compensate for it, it's just going to get a 6 from me. From a vocal point of view, he's a very, very strong singer, one of the best of the year, and I would say definitely among the best of the male vocalists, so he's going to get a 9. Up next is Poland, one of the sort of more straightforward girl bops that we have this year, and one that I wish I had more positive things to say about, but I just don't. Just about every choice here from a visual point of view I find to be irritating. They're overcompensating with filters and transitions, the use of LEDs is uninspired and at times really tacky, and what is this unnecessary pyro? What does it add exactly? I can at least say that the choreography is tightly executed, but it's really not enough to make up for the rest of it, so this is getting a 4. With respect to the vocal performance, I don't think much can be said about how technically good this was. From my point of view, there were quite a few misses, and this isn't, at least from what I can tell, a very challenging song to sing, so that has to be taken into consideration. Vocals are going to be a 4.5. As for the song, I mean, I don't find it to be anything new or remarkable. It's at least like an effective earworm and decently produced, but none of that is enough to really make up for it to bring it into like much higher numbers, so that's going to get a 5. After that, we have Serbia, a very unique package overall, and one that feels quite new for Eurovision. From a visual point of view, I feel it's kind of a mixed bag. I really, really love the moment when the monster is revealed and you hear the bass and the distorted synth. It just feels very menacing, and it's a great lead into the rest of the song. Towards the end is where things start to fall apart for me, particularly the moment where the dancers are being unplugged. With the graphics and everything that's happening on stage, it just feels quite cluttered, and then the dance that follows, I have to say, just looks a little bit silly to me. I am gonna settle on a 7 for the visuals because I admire the ambition. I'm not so crazy about the execution, but I feel like, you know, landing somewhere in the middle is fair enough. With the performance, I understand that this is not meant to be a song that demonstrates, you know, superior vocal ability, but I still feel as if there is a connection that's being missed between myself as the viewer and Luke, and it's the kind of thing that I expect to get from any other performance. It's almost as if he just kind of fades into the background. So for that reason, I'm gonna give it a 6 because it's not necessarily bad. And with respect to the song, it's also a bit of a mixed bag. It has some elements that I like and some elements that I don't. But one thing that I connected to quite a bit is the sound design. And when I was in the arena for the grand final rehearsal, it sounded phenomenal. It was just, it helped me experience the song in a way that I hadn't felt before. And so the song is going to get a 7.5, again, for similar reasons to the staging. I see the artistry, execution, I'm not 100% sold on. After that, we have France. And I think that the person who came up with the best description of what France's song was this year would be Gustav from Belgium, who described it as Edith Piaf going to Studio 54. Perfect. Visually, it's quite captivating, especially the opening. I think that it does something that I think is such an important quality in making sure that people pay attention, which is nailing that first shot. Because she's elevated on a pillar, there's only so much movement that she can provide herself, but she really does everything within her power, being all the way up there to give that movement. The rest of the movement comes from the lights, and I think that it's still pretty well done. The only issue that I have is that it didn't stay interesting for long enough. There were certain areas that felt a little bit more low energy or just not as engaging, but because it was so impressive and had a very clear visual identity, it's going to get an 8. Vocally speaking, Lazara did have some misses with her singing, but at the very least, she still maintained a level of power and detail in her voice, so she's going to get a 7. And the song will be a 7.5. It's enjoyable, danceable, something to put on for fun, but I don't really see it as much more than that. We then go to Cyprus, which is another entry here where a lot of consideration is given to the color palette. The lighting is really on point. It uses shadows to set the mood and give a bit of texture, but it doesn't have a ton of character, I have to say. It's definitely good to be atmospheric, but it doesn't really supplement the meaning of the song, and I don't really have any memorable standout moments for me. So because it's lacking a level of interest, I'm tempted to put it at a 6, but I do still recognize the technical qualities of it, so it's going to be a 6.5. Vocally, it was a fairly strong performance. I understand that there were a few slight misses here and there, but this is definitely a more challenging song to sing. You can hear that he's singing in a lot of different registers, so he's going to get an 8.
hate.
And with the song, it's not a real big standout of mine, but I can recognize certain qualities in the songwriting that make it memorable. It at least has a hook and it feels cohesive, so it's gonna get a 7. After that, we have Spain. And if you've seen any of my previous videos, you would know that I'm a huge fan of what they brought this year. I had quite a strong emotional response to it when we saw this for the first time at Benidorm Fest, and I'm just really, I admire it so much. Visually, this is everything I could ask for. Striking images, dynamic lighting and movement, meaningful artistic choices. I'm completely in love with it, and it's easily one of my favorite Eurovision performances. Now, there does seem to be something missing that I can't quite put my finger on. When I watch the Benidorm Fest performance, I get the feeling quite a bit more than I do when watching the Eurovision performance. So I'm not going to let that be a factor in the scoring, but it's just something that I think about, and I'm trying to figure out what it is exactly that makes those performances feel so different to me. As for what numbers I'm going to be giving to Spain, 9 for the visuals for all the reasons that I just said, 9 for the song as well because it takes me to a different place and I just find it so compelling, and 9.5 for the vocals because they are just incredible. We then have Sweden, our winner. Unlike with Spain, where I can't really identify what the difference is between the national selection performance and the Eurovision one, with Sweden it's quite clear. The larger LEDs made the whole thing feel more impressive, and they provided a greater sense of tension throughout the performance. Again, we're not going to make it a factor into how we score the song, it's just an observation. We're going to treat it as it is. One thing that I admire immensely about how this performance was put together is that it was conceived to tell the story in a way that we hadn't seen before, and with elements that just feel like they fit together naturally. From the physical presence of the LEDs to the inverting camera, the sand, the nails, the designs on the screens, it all sticks in your head so clearly and it just feels so elegantly made. The downside, unfortunately, is that I don't think that the camera work was ever able to fully capture the energy of the song. They were definitely trying to get it closer to the Melfest performance in the rehearsals, but they were never really able to get it. It ends up being the one thing that's missing for me and really lessens the impact. So it's going to get an 8.5, and for reference, the Melfest performance would be a solid 10 out of 10. Loreen's performance will get a 9, and this would be a bit higher if we were going off of some of the earlier performances. This one, for the grand final, was a bit more noticeably flat. It's not going to be enough to really bring down the score because she still has that insane resonance in her voice, and she's no less present than she normally is, so 9 seems fair. And then we get to the song, which is usually the area that is criticized the most. People say that it's soulless, manufactured, unoriginal. And here I am giving it a 9. Why? The sound design is incredible. Everything that Loreen brings to it in the studio version and in the live performance is just amazing. And most importantly, I feel it. And I'm sorry if you don't. After that, we have Albania, a very charming entry, one that I wasn't 100% sure would make it to the final, but it was one of those moments where I was very happy to be wrong. Visually speaking, it does some clever things. I like the fact that they've positioned each family member behind one of the sections of the LED walls, and that they use imagery that evokes like roots to imply a family tree or like a bloodline. I also really enjoy the dance that they do. It's clearly a meaningful choice with respect to the message of the song, and it's definitely the most memorable moment when I think about the entire performance. The rest of it I didn't find to be all that memorable, but at the very least it's technically well made, so I'm gonna settle on a 7. The vocal performance will get an 8, clearly some strong vocals from Albina and some great harmonies from the rest of the family. And the song will get a 7. It's enjoyable, I like the instrumentation, I just have a hard time recognizing what's remarkable about it, and that could just be a bias on my part. It could be a cultural bias, or it's just, you know, my lack of musical theory, a real in-depth knowledge of musical theory. So for that reason, I'm not going to devalue it either. 7 feels like the right place to put it. From there, we go to Italy. Marco Mengoni, a returning artist, bringing a level of class that's needed in a contest that is so loud and energetic. The visuals that they've gone with are fairly simplistic. They keep the focus on him, and everything that's happening in the background is meant to be more of an accent rather than to pull your attention away. There's also storytelling that's happening with the acrobats, and my impression is that they're supposed to represent the two lives in the song, the conscious and the subconscious. It's a less is more approach, which is definitely respectable. I don't find it to be all that memorable, I have to say, because when I think back to the song, I think more about Marco singing to the camera. Originally, I had this down as a 7, but at least because I can say that there's something, there's at least that element that's jumping out at me, maybe this should be a 7.5, but I'll think about that by the time we get to the end of the show. The rest, I can be a lot more positive about. The song is beautifully composed. I especially love the lead melody and all the directions that it takes. It gets an 8.5. And Marco's performance is definitely one of the best. He gets a 9. Estonia follows with another strong vocal performance, one of the best qualities of the overall act. So let's just get that part out of the way and give her a 9 because she deserves it. The visuals, on the other hand, I'm not that crazy about. I don't really understand the self-playing piano, and I don't think it's interesting enough of a visual to justify all the camera time that it has. This shot in particular really drags on and feels quite forced. The rest of it is fine, and it looks elegant, but it's just not all that interesting, so it's gonna get a 6.5. The song, on the other hand, is quite nice. Not a real big standout for me, but I can at least appreciate the dramatic arc that it has. I'm sure that there would be other people who would really, really get behind this entry. For me, it's gonna be a 7.5 because I definitely recognize it as good, you know, good quality, well made, just not that interesting to me. Then we have Finland, the televote winner, an entry that a lot of people wanted to see win the contest and are clearly not thrilled that that didn't happen. Let's talk about the entry in its entirety. Firstly, the visuals are getting a 9, and I think there's an abundance of reasons for that. All of the elements perfectly match the energy of the song, the LEDs, the camera shots, the lighting, and everything that's happening on stage. They've also got a concept that fits the story within the song. And it's worth mentioning, regardless of how many people watching at home understood it, because it keeps the performance grounded in an idea, which is much better than just doing cool things for the sake of it. And finally, we don't even need to talk about how memorable this performance was. That's clearly demonstrated by the televote score, and I would be very surprised to find people who forgot this entry by the end of the show. The area that must be talked about is the vocal performance, which does have some problems that are hard to ignore. The last part of the song, when Karja is singing, is supposed to be when the alcohol hits and he's freed himself from the shell that he's singing about. He should be looking and sounding that way, but instead he's out of breath and looks uncomfortable. And the problem for me is not necessarily that he's not singing well, it's that it's not convincing. So because I'm someone that values execution, I can't really justify giving a high score in the performance area. But at least considering everything that comes before that, that it is convincing and from my point of view still effective, it's going to come out at a 6, which is not bad. As for the song, it gets a 9, without a doubt. It's catchy, unique, addictive, and one that I'm going to be listening to for many years down the road. Now, considering how big Finland was, it was always going to be a tough act to follow. That responsibility fell on Czechia, unfortunately, but at least they managed to also be fairly impactful and get into the top 10. Visually, I'm a big fan of what they've done. Using this stark white and gray in the backdrop really fits the haunting feeling of the song, and it almost gives this imagery of like a prison. Having everyone dressed in pink also acts as a really nice contrast to that really stark feeling, and the way that all the movement is done feels really meaningful and helps create a number of memorable moments throughout the song. The entire package is very easy to recognize, so overall I'm giving the visuals an 8.5. The vocals didn't strike me as particularly remarkable, and there were certain moments where I didn't feel as if I was getting Patricier's full voice, but it's still overall good, so I'm gonna give it a 7. As for the song, I would be giving it an 8 if I was just going off like the musical qualities, but I'm gonna bring it down to a 7.5 because I find the language mishmash to be a bit forced. It seems like the kind of decision that was made because this song was going to Eurovision rather than for the sake of it being a song. Australia is the first of our rock bands to take to the stage, and one of the challenges is always going to be making your staging more than you just being up there playing your instruments. In this case, they brought a car, which is a central point of the performance and definitely adds to the visual identity. Now, I'm a bit torn on this because I think having Danny sitting in the car looking pensive, singing the opening lines is quite cheesy, but at least it adds for an interesting element that leads to some evolution before we actually get to the regular band setup with the other members playing their instruments. Everything else works, I would say. We've got dynamic lighting, colors, shadows. It's all very nice, so it will get a 7.5. The performance will also get a 7.5. I didn't think the vocals were particularly amazing, but they make up for it a lot with their presence. They just have a lot of fun on stage, and you can feel that when watching them. And the song will also get a 7.5. I don't really connect to it on a lyrical level, but I'm much more interested in what's happening with the instrumentation, and it takes a lot of unexpected turns, so that I really admire. Belgium follows that with our 90s Eurodance throwback, a sound that I have a lot of nostalgia for, but with that comes a lot of expectations for how I feel like this is supposed to be done. I was hoping that they were going to really play into that kind of black and white silhouette concept fully, because a lot of music videos from that era had that aesthetic, and they did exactly that, so I'm really happy about that. They also give us quite a few standout moments. My favorites are the opening with Gustav's double silhouette, when they sing "Look at us now," and you get this kind of like family portrait arrangement. And then of course the voguing dancer at the end, which just felt like the cherry on top, brought out a lot of excitement from the crowd, and it just felt like the right thing to do at the right time. My only reservation is that I don't feel like the energy was fully matched by the movement of the cameras and what was happening on stage, but it's still gonna be an 8 because I can clearly see that there was a lot of thought and care put into the idea. The vocal performance is also very strong, very commendable. I think an 8 seems pretty appropriate. And the song will get a 7.5. I'm bringing it down slightly because of certain lyrical cliches that I find a bit annoying, but it doesn't necessarily make the song that much less enjoyable, so 7.5 seems fair. Next we have Armenia, which was an entry that really surprised me when I watched it for the first time and has a lot of elements that I really enjoyed. The angled plane working both as a projection screen and a platform was very smart if you ask me, and it allowed them to use the same space to give different looks and add to the evolution of the performance. Again, it feels like there was something missing in the grand final performance that I can't put my finger on. I don't really know what it is, but I'm not gonna let it be a factor in the scoring. This is a 9 because it's just really effective and helped me understand the song a lot better. Brunette's performance will get an 8. She expresses the emotions of the song pretty effectively without like needing to hit a high note just to show off her vocals. And the song is gonna get a 7.5, being brought down slightly because of some clunkiness in the lyrics. It just feels like sometimes the words don't fit really naturally into the melody, and it's something that just kind of hits my ear awkwardly, but otherwise it's still pretty good. Up next is Moldova, bringing the kind of folk electronica banger that people really enjoy at Eurovision. The visuals definitely fit the vibe of the song quite nicely, and the part that I enjoy the most is the kind of theatrical dialogue between Pasha and the flautist. Even the way that he's introduced in the song acts as a bit of a surprise, and the whole dynamic that they have really contributes to the storytelling. There are certain other aspects of the performance that are a bit of a cliche for Eurovision, like the drummers, the elaborate costumes and such, but because I can still see the uniqueness of it overall and that it's memorable, it's gonna get an 8. Now, watching this for a second time, I was actually quite surprised to see how much of a difference there was in Pasha's vocals from the semifinal, and I rewatched that one just to make sure that I wasn't imagining things, because like he was always pretty breathy, but in this one he was a bit more noticeably pitchy. So again, I can't really justify giving it that high of a score, but at least I can understand that the performance is quite physical and that he's still making up for it in his stage presence, so it's gonna be a 6 overall. And the song is getting an 8, really well produced, I really enjoy it. I only feel like it lacks a proper climax, but because I'm still into it leading up to it, it's not enough to compromise it for me. Following that, we have Ukraine, who prove once again why they do so well at Eurovision. They know how to stage. The quad split projection screen gives the song a unique visual identity, and they integrate it in creative ways, like having Jeffrey be able to disappear behind it. And then the way that they integrate that into the LEDs behind it is also really smart, because it makes everything feel that much bigger. And there's also something that's happening with the movement that I feel fits the song quite well, given the groove that it has. The camera movements are fairly restrained and slow moving, but everything that's happening on the stage is quite fast, so having that contrast actually works really well. Very solid overall, maybe lacking like a real standout moment, but I think 8.5 is certainly deserved. With regards to the performance, there was some pitchiness here and there, but it wasn't enough for me to like really devalue it, so it's gonna get a 7.5. And the song is gonna get an 8 because I feel like although it's not the most impressive song that we have this year, it still has a unique sound to it, especially like the hook and that, you know, kind of unique groove that I was talking about before. And I feel like it upholds the quality that we expect from Ukraine at Eurovision. From there, we move on to Norway, one of this year's fan favorites, and one that actually translated into quite a bit of televote success. Now, if you've heard me talk about Norway before, you would know that I'm not a big fan of pointing at your metaphor. And in this case, it's because Alessandra is singing about a queen of kings and dressed like a queen. And in addition to that, we just have some dancers in the background background that really only exists to fill out the empty space, it just feels a bit like lame and uninspired, if you ask me. I will say that the dark atmosphere and the dynamic lighting definitely matches the energy of the song, so it saved a little bit, but not enough to really get me to recognize this as being like a real strong standout. And so I've settled on a 6.5, which is really mostly the marks coming down for the queen representing obviousness. Vocally, Alessandra can clearly sing. There's a lot of registers going on there. It might not have been the most flawless performance, but it's at least impressive to me, so I'm gonna give it an 8. And for the song, I do enjoy it, and I feel like the lyrics have a nice flow to them, but I just wish that they had gone with a sound that wasn't so dated, because we've heard this kind of, you know, triplet EDM banger in festivals and on the radio for the last like 10 years. So it's gonna be a 7.5 overall. Following that, we have Germany, which was an act that I once said was probably going to be the best chance at getting out of the bottom five. That didn't happen, but at least we can say that it still got more points than the last two German entries combined. Visually speaking, they give us all the things that you would expect out of a rock performance. You got the pyro, the quick camera cuts, the big light show. It's all there. There's not much else to it. And so I have a hard time justifying any kind of like favorability when compared to everything that we've seen before it, but it still works. And so I'll settle on a 7 for the visuals. The part that I'm probably gonna get dragged for is that I'm giving the song a 6. And this was actually me bringing it up from a 5 before, because I realized that it's not necessarily a laziness thing. It's just that there are certain aspects of it that I find to be a bit disjointed. The part that really sticks out is the change to triplets in the verses. I just don't understand what that's for, and it just comes off as really jarring. And then the melody itself I find to be quite monotonous and a bit irritating, if I'm being honest. If you are a fan of the song, by all means, let me know in the comments what you think it is that I'm missing. Again, I don't think that it was like lazily made or anything. I just feel like it's lacking a bit of cohesion. Vocally speaking, I have nothing to criticize. Chris is very clearly a talented singer. I think that somebody who has more insight into the kind of technique required for this would have more things to say, but I'll settle on an 8 because it still seems impressive to me. After that, we have Lithuania, an entry that I'm fairly fond of and was pretty happy to see that it did quite well in the final score. I really like how they chose to present this song, the color scheme. I love the images that we see on the LEDs, and I love the brief interactions that we get between Monica and her singers. As a concept, it's not necessarily anything new, it's not reinventing the wheel, but I think that it suits the song, which is really the most important thing, so I'm gonna give it an 8. They all perform beautifully as well, I'm giving them an 8, and the song itself will also be an 8. I just really like the melody, and as an entire package, it's just really pleasing. Makes me feel like I'm getting a nice warm hug. It's very wholesome. Then we have Israel, the song that really came out on top when we put aside the two-horse race that we had been talking about for so long with Sweden and Finland. Lots of fans of this song, and I definitely risk being dragged for what I'm about to say about it. So buckle up. When it comes to the visuals, it really is mostly about the choreography above everything else. And like, what can I say? It's pretty tight. If we were to just go off of that, then I could certainly give this an 8. There are certain elements that are really turning me off. Like, everything that's happening on the LEDs makes what feels like a gimmicky song that much more gimmicky. So I've settled on a 7. I was gonna be more complimentary of her vocals because my impression from watching in the press center was that she was nailing it pretty much every time. But watching it again, I can hear the power in her voice, but there's definitely moments where the control is a bit wonky. So what would otherwise be an 8 goes down to a 7.5, and then that goes down to a 7 because there's no singing in the climax of the song. For a contest that's all about the live performance, that just feels wrong, and I really wish that wasn't allowed. And then when it comes to the song, like, it's catchy and it's well produced, but I just don't understand what the meaning of everything that comes before Do You Want to See Me Dance is. Like, it almost feels like you could have put anything there that is pop friendly and easily digestible, and it would have been the same thing. This would be a 5 if you ask me, but I will bring it up to a 5.5 because I do actually like the feminine part. It's like the one part that I think is pretty clever, and you could almost make the entire song that, and I would like it a bit more. Following that is Slovenia, an entry that really impressed me the first time I saw it. I was hoping that this was going to be Slovenia's best result ever. It didn't turn out that way, but at least we have them back in the final. Part of what really sold me on the performance the first time I saw it was that they were just having a great time on stage. They're clearly enjoying themselves and performing with some personality as well as a bit of humor. It does get a bit silly at times, but at least they're being themselves, and the light show that goes with it adds a lot of energy and rounds things out pretty nicely, so this is going to be an 8 for the visuals. Vocally speaking, if I was just going off of Bojan's vocals, this would be an 8.5 or a 9, because he sounds exactly like the studio version. But in thinking about some of the comments that I made about Israel and the fact that there isn't enough singing at the point where there should be singing, one thing that I did notice after watching it a few times is that the backing vocals are miming, and that also doesn't feel appropriate. So I'm gonna have to take that into consideration and just leave it at an 8. And the song itself will also get an 8. I really enjoy it, and it's definitely one that I would love to experience in a proper live setting with all live instruments. We continue with Croatia, the love it or hate it song of the year, and the first Eurovision performance in a long time that really got me laughing. We don't even need to talk about whether or not they succeed in giving this a visual identity. That in itself would be like an 11 out of 10. But with respect to all the elements, I think it's very well done. The energy is matched by the movements. We get some nice progression from start to finish, and we even get a little Macarena-style dance so that we can all take part. Now, this might not be a high-production cinematography masterpiece, but I'm still giving this an 8.5 because, like it or not, this was an experience and one that I thoroughly enjoyed. The singing, on the other hand, I can't really defend as being spectacular. Definitely some rough parts. Also not necessarily a song that's trying to be vocally impressive, so I'll give it a 6. As for the song, I'm giving it an 8.5. And sure, that would be absurdly high for some people who don't even classify this as music, but I truly believe that this was not lazily made, and I want for people who consider themselves to be music fans to listen to the instrumental version, take in all the details, and tell me if your opinion has changed slightly. I understand that it's still going to be too crass for people to really like, but just as an exercise, I'd be curious to hear what you have to say. Finally, we end with our hosts, the United Kingdom, who didn't get the finish that they were hoping for following the success of Sam Ryder. At least May has been taking it in stride. She's accepted that she wasn't at her best, and the song is still showing signs of life on the charts, so it definitely wasn't all for nothing. With respect to the visuals, I find it to be a bit of a mixed bag. I do like the pastel color palette and the kind of scrapbook aesthetic that they've got, but at times it just feels a bit cluttered, and there's like too many things competing for my attention. As far as the movement goes, the energy is provided a lot by the dancers, even more than May herself, and it seems like the natural choice for a song like this, but I don't really find anything to be interesting about it, and to be honest, it's hard to notice them with everything that's going on around it. So while there are aspects that I do respect about this, it definitely could have benefited from a less is more approach, and so I'm going to settle on a 6 because you definitely see the professionalism behind it, but maybe not the focus. The performance I can't really say too many positive things about, and again, even May has admitted that she wasn't at her best, so it's going to be a 5.5, maybe next time. And the song itself I also find to be a bit monotonous, but I do find that the production is very clean, and I can certainly see the radio airplay appeal in it, so it's going to be a 6.5. Yeah, definitely a bit of a bum note to end on, but that's all the songs. Now we have to rank them. So here we have all the songs ranked in order of their total points. Now, if I was really on a jury, there would be another 4 jurors who would have their own rankings, and all of them would be combined together to come up with the top 10 songs that would receive points. But for the purposes of the video, let's just say that these are the songs that get points from the country of me, the country of Stu. For comparison, here is how each of these songs place in my personal ranking, which I have, but I just don't really share because I don't think it's that interesting. One of the criticisms of the jury system is that people feel as if they're not really being objective, they're just voting like any member of the public would, but with a lot more influence on the overall result. In my ranking, there's certainly some overlap with my own personal preferences, but it wasn't purely that. I was taking other factors into consideration, and I can only do so much to convey that I'm making these decisions in good faith. Ultimately, it meant not being able to give as many points as I would have liked to Finland, Austria, and Portugal, and not giving any points to Croatia and Moldova, who are in my personal top 10. Armenia gets 7 points, even though I'm sort of lukewarm on the song. And a lot of that has to do with how much I respect about the staging and that it was also a fairly impressive vocal performance. Switzerland didn't really get any points, but it still finishes in 15th, despite the fact that in my personal ranking, I have it as 32nd out of 37 songs. If you were to take this ranking and combine it with 4 other jurors who really liked Switzerland, then this could have resulted in fairly big points. Now, there's another part where personal preference does come into play, and as you can see, there are quite a few groups of songs with identical scores. And usually what I do to decide which one to put above the other is I go off of how I evaluated the song, because that's what matters most to me. And then if that number is still the same, then it's simply which of the two I like more. I've seen people say that it shouldn't be about personal preference, that the jurors should be objective. But wouldn't it at some point? Because if you feel equally about 2 songs, one of them still has to go ahead of the other. And how else are you going to make that decision? Ideally, what you want is for the jurors to be bringing in a level of insight that the average person wouldn't have. And that could be about technique, about composition, really about the kind of things that are outlined in the criteria. And the reason for having multiple jurors from all the countries is so that you get a difference of opinion with different people from different cultural backgrounds recognizing different qualities in music. So on that note, let's compare the ranking that I've made to how the juries voted this year, keeping in mind that I was not using the exact same criteria, but still trying to make a sort of evaluation. 49 jurors had Croatia ranked last. And I think most people would understand why. It's just not the kind of song that people see as pleasant. Is it wrong of me to have ranked it as high as 12th? Or is that for the better because I think that there's artistic qualities that are being overlooked? 70 jurors had Israel in their top 5, which again is fairly expected because they brought a big performance that is very Eurovision friendly. Should I rethink putting them in 24th? Or should I be allowed to have my criticisms when I feel like it was all about the dance routine and the song was an afterthought? Finally, there were only 7 jurors that put Spain first, like I did, and another 12 that put it in their top 3. Should we have expected the rest of the jurors to be equally as enthusiastic and respond to the artistry? Or does the low televote score say anything about how some people just don't get it? The reason why I'm pointing all this out is because it's very easy for us as fans to look at someone's ranking, pick it apart, and insist that it was wrong because it doesn't fit our ideas of who deserved better. It's very likely that some of you had that exact same feeling when I was giving my thoughts about the songs. Whether or not it's fair to give 5 people so much power when so much of their judgment is subjective is definitely debatable. But that's the kind of thing we're going to talk about in more detail when I finally get this other video done. If you haven't done so already, I would love if you subscribe to the channel so that you can check that out eventually. In the meantime, try this out for yourself. See how your own attempt at assessing the songs compares to your own personal ranking and share the results in the comments. You could also just tell me about how my opinion is wrong and how I don't know what I'm talking about, but for the algorithm, it's all the same and I really don't mind. Thank you as always, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.